Let's look at this. Do we know this? Have you guys seen this? I realized this about a year ago. A friend pointed this out to me, maybe a little bit more than a year ago. What is, other than them being both being SAG, Screen Actors Guild actors, what do they have in common in the picture right there? What's that? Receding hairline, maybe. How's this? 48 years old, 49 years old. 49, 48. Yeah. Cocoon, when Cocoon was filmed, Wilford Brimley was 49. When World War Z was filmed, Brad Pitt was 48. There's one year chronological difference between those two pictures. Now, there's 30 years difference between when those movies were shot. That movie was shot in the early 80s. This movie was shot 2 or 3 years ago. What does Mr. Pitt now have that Mr. Brimley probably didn't have? Personal trainer, personal chef, personal assistant. Yeah, he probably does manscaping. He does, you know, he does Botox. He probably takes supplemental energy. I mean, he probably does. Half of Hollywood is on supplemental androgens. I mean, you got to train like a superhero to get these movie roles. So he's training, but the point is he's training differently. He's behaving differently, and he's investing in his body. But there's a huge difference, because you can ask your clients, if you ask any of your clients in their 40s, who do you want to look like when you're 48, 49 years old, what do you think the response is going to come back? That. And there's a way that we can influence that. There's a nutrition component of it, which I'm not really going to get into, but there's really the exercise, the stress application. So how about this? What about age? I love this stat. Nolan Ryan started pitching in the major leagues a year before Robin Ventura was born. Now, this is going back a few years, so some of you that were born in the late 80s, early 90s, you might not remember this, but those of us that were in college at this time, we remember what happened when these two met up. They've been going, the Rangers and the White Sox have been kind of going back and forth all year long. Robin Ventura had gotten a homer off of Ryan in an earlier game, so when Ventura came up and Nolan Ryan threw at him, gave him a brushback, because Nolan Ryan hated having people hit off him. And so Nolan Ryan threw him a little chin music. That's what happened. Ventura rushed the mound, and Ryan, who started playing in the major leagues before Ventura was born, took care of his business. He handled himself. You know, and it's like, is that because of age, or is that because of the way he acted, the way he trained? Nolan Ryan pitched until his late 40s. Gaylord Perry pitched until his late 40s. You have a bunch of athletes that played. You know, Brett Favre, the last season, maybe not the best example, but Brett Favre and Vinny Testaverde played in the NFL until their early 40s. You know, I had a buddy I played rugby with in Boston. The only reason he stopped playing rugby at 57 years old is he lost an eye. It was a freak accident and lost the cornea, got a thumb in the eye and lost the cornea. But he was playing rugby in his 50s with a bunch of 20-year-olds. Stuff like that, age is nothing but a number. So when you have clients tell us, well, I'm old, so what? That doesn't matter. You know, all it is how do we train? You know, exercise can mitigate the aging process. And I apologize about this, but I converted this from a Mac file to a PowerPoint file and didn't realize this until I get a chance to fix it. But aging, we have three types. There are different types of aging, but three primary types. Chronological aging will not change. That's from the time you were born until now. Until we develop the flux capacitor, we're not going to be able to change the chronological aging process. So until Doc Brown comes up and creates the DeLorean that can go back to 1956, we're kind of stuck with who we are and what we have. Biological age are the progressive changes to the cells, the tissues, the organs, all the systems within our body. Functional age is our ability to function, our ability to perform activities of daily living. Now, your clients, how many of us have clients in their 40s and 50s that still like to stay recreationally active? Or even clients in their 60s? They probably like that. They probably want to be active. When you look at a lot of literature out there on training the older over 50 adult, it's rather rudimentary and, to my mind, rather boring. You know, it's like training over 50 population, you know, let's do machines, let's do very stable training. Well, if they've been active their whole lives, that's not going to be sufficient for what they want. So what we can change with exercise and what we can change with the right type of training program is we can change biological age, which is the age of our tissues and our systems, and we can change functional age, our ability to perform, our ability to do what we want to do. My personal definition of fitness is having the ability to do what you want to do when you want to do it. Having the ability to do what you want to do when you want to do it. In my mind, you know, that's much better than taking selfies of my six-pack abs in an Instagram and, you know, throwing that up on the internet. If that's what you want to do, great, fine, train for that. I'd rather train to be out to go mountain biking. I'd rather train to be able to play at the park with my kids. I'd rather be able to train to make connections, tight flights when you have to go from one place to another. And I think that's what our clients want. Our clients want to have the energy to do that. They want to have the ability, especially clients in their 50s and 60s, want to play with their grandkids. For some people in their 50s, they want to play with their kids. You know, I know people that are in their 50s that have teenagers that want to keep up with them or need to keep up with them. So we need to look at what are they training for. It's not just about appearance, but it's about function. So real quick, what I'm going to talk about today is tissues, primarily skeletal, primarily the muscular and the fascial systems, and a little bit about system. The system I'll really talk about is the endocrine system. I've already referred to, but all these systems are affected by the aging process. All these systems get affected by the passage of time. And I, you know, when you look at it, the big thing for me is I'm a Gen Xer, tried and true. Soundgarden, Pearl Jam, flannel in the early 90s, all that fun stuff. In fact, my playlists are about still stuck in 1994. You know, but when you look at it, Gen X is turning 50 years old now. Gen X is from 1964 to 1979. WHO is the World Health Organization. It's estimated within the next 15 years, there's going to be more than 1.2 billion, with a B, people over the age of 60 around the world. That's not just in the States, but around the world. So we know that there's a large, large market here. Plus, what's the big thing about people over 45? Do they have more money than people under 45? Generally speaking, yeah. I wrote an article last year for IDEA on training the master athlete. It's interesting, the number of trainers I talk to when they first start their careers that say, I want to train athletes is astronomical. Professional athletes are less than 0.5% of our population. Professional athletes are less than 0.5%. And I'm counting all professional athletes, from bowlers to bull riding to football to baseball. So you're looking at less than 1% of the population is professional athletes. Yet you talked about 90% of trainers coming out of college starting their career in fitness, and they say they want to train professional athletes. The numbers don't work out. So my argument is that if we look at older adults with disposable income and train them like performance athletes, meaning identify what their performance goals are, identify what they want to do well, because that's what we do when we train athletes, right? We identify what they need for their sport, what they need for their position, and we train them to be skilled in that. Well, when we work with an older adult clientele, we just need to define what is your outcome. Put a performance parameter on it, and then go backwards just like we would an athlete and train that. So that's my argument is exercise, if we do it the right way, we should be training everybody with that athletic mindset. And I think that's what shifted in the last number of years, thanks to people like Greg Cook promoting the functional movement screen, and this whole thought process of movement before muscle is getting us thinking that way. So when we look at it, exercise is the fountain of youth. You can market it. So for your program, I would kind of move away from active aging and promote the fountain of youth. Be younger, look younger, feel younger. That becomes the target words. And it's fact. It works. The younger you start, the better results you get. If you talk to people in their mid-30s, late 30s, early 40s, and what time of our life is that? That's the time we start having kids, right? And the time we start getting busy with our careers, between about 35 and maybe early 40s. So fitness, exercise, for people that aren't committed to it, it becomes very easy to kind of push aside. Because if we have one or two kids, if I get busy, if I get that promotion, I get more responsibility, all of a sudden they make staff cuts. They fire half my team, but give me the responsibility. Now I'm spending 10, 12 hours a day at work. I come home, I have two kids to take care of. It just fitness gets put on the back burner. It's not about, when you get to that point, it's not about how you look. It's about if you start training younger, you maintain your healthy appearance, you maintain your youthful energy for a longer period of time. That becomes a very powerful argument. It literally is like this. I'm a car fan. You can take an old car and renew it, or if this is a new car, I think that's like 63 or 64 GTO, if you take care of it, if you change the oil, you do the regular tune-ups, you keep it in the garage, you wash it, you polish it, you can maintain it and keep it for 50-something, 60 years, and it'll still drive like new. Which is easier to do, maintain a car or rebuild a car? That's going to cost you a lot more money in the long run, especially if you're trying to match numbers. It's not going to work that well. So that's the same thing with our clients. We can either rebuild your tissue, rebuild it from the ground up, and we have to do it with the right exercise program, or we help you maintain what you have and maintain your functional, kind of keep your functional envelope for a longer period of time. So real quick, the effects of aging without exercise. The top ones there are really big, really important. over the age of 30 without exercise, we start losing muscle mass. We start losing muscle mass. We lose explosive strength and power. If we're not doing strength training or power training over the age of 40, the type 2 muscle fibers, specifically the type 2 motor units, the nervous system function, which activates the muscle fibers, becomes dormant because they're not being used. We don't lose them. They don't fall off the body, but they just lie dormant. It's like cutting off power to a light switch. The switch is still on the wall, but if you just detach it from the electrical grid, it's not going to work. So the right training can keep that engaged. And this is why you're seeing all those testosterone commercials. That's a real physiological function. More power to the drug companies. They realize, hey, testosterone declines naturally over the age of 35. We'll come up, we'll create this issue of low T, and we'll start selling testosterone on TV so that people go in their doctors and ask for it. But in reality, you can mitigate or you can slow down that loss with the proper strength training program. Because what do we know about strength training? Strength training promotes what? Testosterone production. It promotes activation of type 2 fibers. So that's what we can do with our strength program, is we design strength programs to promote the muscle-building hormones. Usually I use these pictures for don't let friends lift light weights for high reps. But I think due to Brad Schoenfeld's work, we can kind of change that, because he's showing that light weights to fatigue is inducing hypertrophy. But I just love these pictures, because I'm like, man, that's indicative of what we think. So just going to touch on, because I think, and I know I got short on, it's only 50 minutes. GH is a very, very important, that's very important with our body for mechanical restructuring. Two hormones, GH and insulin-like growth factor, are really responsible for helping repair the mechanical damage caused by weightlifting. So when we look at the weightlifting that we do, it damages the protein structures. GH helps promote the response of the satellite cells to model the new tissue and build the new fibers. It increases the protein synthesis, increases uptake of amino acids in cells. It also increases fat metabolism. So it helps release fat for energy. So if you have an exercise protocol that boosts the GH, it also can help with fat metabolism in the exercise recovery period. It also stimulates release of IGF, insulin-like growth factor. It promotes immune cell function. And for women in the room, and I had a couple female-specific studies, because women have a very similar hormone response to exercise than men. The only difference is women generally tend to promote more GH or produce more GH. But due to time, I pulled a couple of those references out. Not because of the women issue, but I was trying to cut back some slides, and I realized after this morning session that I didn't have the time to put it in there. But the research shows that women have a pretty similar response to men, but they just produce slightly more GH. So that's the thing, because they lack two very important things, which I'll touch on in a second. So IGF, insulin-like growth factor, or mechanogrowth factor is another name for it. Those are pretty synonymous. What they do is they help repair. It's a polypeptide. So a steroid works on the nucleus of a cell. A peptide works on the cell membrane. But they both work to help repair and replenish the cell. It works with GH to help with mechanical restructuring. So when muscle fiber is damaged due to weight training, it's the GH and the GF response that helps repair that tissue and helps make that tissue bigger. There are other factors involved as well, but they're the primary hormones that help with the mechanical repair of that. So when you look at it, Schoenfeld has indicated that IGF or MGF is probably the most important anabolic hormone. So that really is something to think about. And those two are tied pretty closely together. And it's interesting to see that the protocols, exercise protocols, are going large muscle mass exercises. This one study looked at squats and bench press. So it was very limited in the exercise selection. But it looked at the rest intervals, 60-second rest interval, 90-second rest interval, or 2-minute rest interval. Same exercises, same intensity to failure, 4 sets. They took the testing before, immediately after the exercise, and 30 minutes after the exercise. And what they found was 60-second had a greater GH response, so it produced more GH relative to T. 90 seconds increased more testosterone, and 120 seconds you actually lose a little bit of T in terms of rest and recovery. So if you start looking at your recovery period when you do higher intensity training, you might go till the first set, you might do 85% to about maybe 6 reps. Second set, you might only get 5 reps. But if you keep the recovery intervals relatively short, you're going to promote a response. And there are two reasons for that. One is the mechanical rebuilding, meaning that your body's going to produce more hormones to rebuild the damage caused to the muscle fibers. The other is there's a direct correlation between the amount of blood lactate or acidosis and GH. So they're still not 100% sure why, but what they know when they do these studies is whenever blood lactate rises, you generally tend to get a response of an elevated GH as well. So that you create a metabolic stress in the body, and that's what lactate responds to, is you get an increased metabolic stress. You also get an increase in the growth hormone and IGF-1. So they tie pretty closely together. BDNF, how many people are familiar with what this is? Because it's not quite a hormone, it's a neurotransmitter, brain-derived neurotrophic factor. It's been written about more and more recently. This is the miracle grow for the brain. That's what a couple doctors are calling it, BDNF. So what it is it helps create new neurons in our brain. It wires and repatterns our brain cells. So it encourages neurogenesis, formation of new cells. It improves oxygen flow to the brain, which helps improve cognition. Aerobic exercise 2 times a week can cut dementia by 50% and the risk of Alzheimer's by 60%. So when you start talking to people in their 50s and 60s who claim they don't have time for exercise, that's an important factor to point out. I don't need you to kill yourself. I don't need you to train for a marathon. I just need you to start elevating your activity level. Because if we can elevate your activity level to start, other stuff will come later. And that's one thing that I really try to get people thinking about. High-intensity exercise works because it has all kinds of responses, but it's not the starting point. It's not the entry point to exercise. It's what we progress to. If we have clients that can benefit from a high-intensity program, it's about a 3 to 6, maybe a 9-month progression. We got to make sure they can move well first before we start loading them up. That's pretty consistent across the board. But when we look at BDNF, the same exercise programs that promote GH and IGF also promote BDNF. So these two studies, one looks at physical activity on the effect of cognition in both older adults and young children, and the other study looked at resistance training and its effect on cognition in older adults, and both found that exercise increases levels of IGF-1, it also increases levels of cognitive function, and that becomes from the BDNF response. So it's a very important thing to think about, that the right type of exercise program is not only going to make our body, make our muscles stronger, it can not only make us cardiorespiratory more efficient, but it can help make our cognitive function smarter and improve our cognitive function. And think about that. How many active older adults do you know that are pretty sharp? They're pretty with it. They're pretty, a lot of good, bright recall. And then compare that to the older adults you know that aren't that active. You can probably see just from who you know and who you picture. And this can kind of affect why. So now we're getting into the big promoter. That's why I use this here because it just amazes me that we're now selling, steroids on TV, basically. But what testosterone does is testosterone enhances muscle protein synthesis. So it helps protein uptake. It helps amino acid uptake. It's one of those big anabolic hormones that helps increase muscle mass in the body. It really is, for men, it's produced in our testes. That's why earlier when I said women don't really need to worry about the testosterone response is because they don't have a right and a left testy. For women, testosterone is produced in the ovaries, and it's produced at a much, much less amount. So when you look at women's response to high-intensity interval training because of the metabolic stress, when you look at women's response to high-intensity strength training because of the mechanical stress, what you're going to get is less testosterone and more growth hormone, and growth hormone is associated with maintaining a more healthy, youthful appearance. So it's kind of important to pay attention to. Factors increasing testosterone loss are aging, loss of lean muscle mass. We saw that earlier as activity declines, type 2 fiber activation goes down, muscle mass can go down. Strength training increases testosterone receptors, so strength training will not only increase free testosterone, but once you create free or circulating testosterone, you need to have certain receptors in the cell that circulating testosterone connects with to do its function. So strength training exercise increases both. It increases circulating testosterone and over time increases testosterone receptors. The important thing, I don't know if I pointed this out earlier, but for both GH and T to really be effective in recovery, we need to get good REM sleep. We need to get good deep sleep to allow the body to properly produce it and properly recover. And that's very important. You know, one of the things I think we need to think about that if we are going to do high intensity training with our clients, and I have asked this and I will ask this, is what are you doing tonight? What are your social plans? Are you going out tonight? What are you doing first thing tomorrow morning? Because if they have a meeting at night or if they have a function at night, and when I trained here in D.C., I used to train across the river at Washington Sports Clubs in downtown, And, you know, I had clients that were very busy because they were in politics, and every evening there's another reception, every morning there's another early morning meeting. But now I would ask, I didn't back then, but now I would ask is, what kind of sleep are you gonna get tonight? Because if you're not gonna, don't have the time, if you're gonna come in late and get up early, I'm not gonna push you that hard today. Because your body's not gonna have a chance to produce the hormones that are gonna be critical to your tissue repair and your tissue recovery. But if they tell me, no, I don't really have anything going on tonight, and you know, tomorrow's gonna be an off day, I don't, you know, I'm not working tomorrow, I'm working from home tomorrow, well, guess what, we're gonna turn it up a little bit. Because that's really when you can kind of engage and get them working a little bit harder. So that's really important to pay attention to, is what's their sleep pattern. Because the way I like to think about it, and what I tell people, and what I tell my classes I teach, is tomorrow's workout starts at the end of today's training session. Tomorrow's workout starts at the end of today's session. How you recover, how you rehydrate, how you refuel, how you sleep is going to set up how you train tomorrow. If you don't do that, if you walk out, no recovery, don't hydrate, don't fuel, you get a crappy night's sleep, and you try to work hard tomorrow, what's going to happen? You're going to sink. It's not going to go that well. So when we walk out of here today, what's your recovery drink? The gym I work in has a bunch of stuff down at the food bar. I recommend grabbing a sandwich or at the very least a chocolate milk, at the very minimum a chocolate milk, because that's going to help you recover. So research says, this is very interesting stuff about testosterone. Three age groups, people in their 20s, men in their 20s, men between 38 and 53, so we'll call that, I don't agree with this, but we'll call it middle age. And then you get people in 59 to 72. And now that I'm in my 40s, 70's not old. You know, it used to be 10, 15 years ago, I thought 70 was old. 70's not old anymore. Mid 80s to 90, yeah, that's old. But now 70's nothing. I look at that as 70 is, the older I get, the younger everybody else gets. But when we look at it, three groups, 20 to 26, 38 to 53, 59 to 72. Same exercise program. The thing about using 80% 1RM is my 80% 1RM might be a different weight than your 80% 1RM, but we're still working at 80% 1RM. So we can keep intensity relatively consistent. So when we look at it, same exercise program, same rest interval, testosterone increased for all groups. Older men at the same rate as younger men. So they didn't increase the same amount, but the older men still increased testosterone at the same rate as the younger men. So there is a positive relationship between resistance training and T production for all ages, between 20 and 70. That's pretty important. That's pretty important to pay attention to and to point out to your clients. You increase muscle mass, you increase your T response for all ages. So older men respond to high intensity training with an increase in T that's similar to younger men. I found a similar thing for aerobic training for women, but due to time, I had to cut that study out. But it was looking at aerobic training and found that older women had the same physiological response to aerobic conditioning that younger women, 30 years younger than them, did. So it's just, you don't get the same net magnitude, but you get the same ratio, if that makes sense. So it is beneficial for both. This is another one, but I think this has more to do with kind of lifestyle choices. Same study, 24 college-age men, not same study, but 24 college-age men, 25 middle-aged men. Again, I don't agree with that definition of middle age. Doing the same workout, they did 4 weeks at 10 RM, and they did 4 weeks at 8 RM. So they did a higher intensity training. They did body comp, they tested bench press, and they tested leg press before and after. And what they found were the older guys increased their bench press and increased their leg press at a pretty consistent rate across the board. The older men, actually what surprised them is increased their lean mass and lost fat mass more than the college age men. So men in their 30s and 40s increased their lean muscle mass and reduce their fat mass at a greater magnitude than the college age men. Now my argument for that would be that men in their 40s, because they only controlled the exercise, they didn't control other factors. My argument would be that men in their 40s are probably getting better sleep and probably eating better than men in their 20s, especially kids in college. Would you agree with that? So I think that's where we can see that we know, but what it shows is how the body responds to that. So this kind of setting the stage for talking about training programs, because does this look like a pretty common training program? Muscle isolation. It's not a bad thing because it is necessary sometimes, but a lot of times when you look at what a lot of people are doing in the gym, they come to the gym, maybe they get their information from a magazine, maybe they get it from a video, but basically when they come to a gym and start working out, they're training in a stable environment, not a bad thing, good place to start, but not where we want to stay for the long term. Maybe they're doing muscle isolation. Again, not a bad place to start because you have to learn the patterns and activate the motor units. They're focusing primarily on concentric action. That's a big kicker. Because what happens to us as we get older? What happens to our tissue? Does resiliency, the ability to lengthen and shorten, does it increase or decrease? It decreases. If we're not training tissue resiliency, then tissue becomes tighter. How many of us know somebody in their 30s that have had an Achilles tendon pop? I know probably half a dozen guys off the top of my head that have, all of them have blown Achilles tendons playing basketball. They're all good athletes, fit athletes, but their training programs don't support what they need to do. They're probably doing more concentric action, and pulling an Achilles tendon is the inability to lengthen rapidly. It's the inability to decelerate ground force. So trying to push explosively without that resiliency in the tissue can lead to a pop Achilles tendon. So it's very important to pay attention to that because these injuries will pop up. So, and a lot of people put, you know, a lot of people, period, put appearance before performance, but my argument is once you get over the age of 40, you got to put performance before appearance. You got to put your movement skill, you have to put your quality of life, you have to put your ability to be functional ahead of appearance. Because training for appearance is one thing, that's fine if you can do selfies, but if you want to have a good quality of life, you need to train to be able to do that quality of life. And here's the interesting thing that I've noted, is that as people kind of shift that mindset away from what the mirror says to their ability to do pull-ups, push-ups, and increase their performance, they have more fun with exercise. You make exercise less about the appearance and more about the fun aspect of it, and it shifts their mindset. It's kind of an interesting thing to see. So looking at muscle, a lot of times we talk about this part of muscle. We talk about the contractile element. That's the actin myosin. That's what shortens and lengthens. That's what generates the force. But what we've only begun talking about in the last couple years is the elastic component. That's critical. Because when we look at these exercises, are these exercises for the contractile element or for the elastic component? These are all contractile. So selectorized machines are critical for strengthening the contractile element. The beautiful bodies that bodybuilders want is all based on contractile. But when we look at movement, when we look at dancers, when we look at martial artists, when we look at wrestlers, do you think they have stronger fascia or stronger contractile? Stronger fascia. They have stronger, more resilient fascia. Their ability to load the elastic tissue is very important. Tom Myers points out that muscles create movement. They generate the force. Fascia just controls it. Fascia tells us where it goes. The interesting thing is when you start dissecting muscles all the way down to the individual muscle fiber, all the way down to the muscle cell, every cell is connected via connective tissue. Every fiber has a layer of connective tissue between it. So when you know, to sit there and think of muscle as something discrete like this is a little bit incomplete. But when you start taking a muscle apart, that's what you see. You have layers. It's not just easy, discrete, you know, circuits like you cut a wire open, but you have layers of tissue that slide across one another. The connective tissue, what we call fuzz, that allows that to slide. Collagen adhesions keep those layers from sliding. Collagen adhesions cause those layers to bind down, and so all the tissue work out there is about breaking up the adhesions to allow that to slide. The group I work with, every January we do a cadaver workshop where we do fresh tissue dissections so we can go through and we show people how this functions. The cadavers aren't preserved, they're frozen but not preserved, as you can go through and see the tissue relatively in its normal state, and it's really amazing to see how the muscles, just the first time I did it, a little overwhelming, but the muscles are not discrete. Every muscle is connected, and the connective tissue is really critical, and you can see how connective tissue will bind in certain people that lose mobility at joints. These are all older adults in their 70s, late 70s and 80s. We had about 6 cadavers there, and you can see where the tissue really bound down and really limited the function. So part of training is not only doing the strength training for the contractile element, but it's doing the movement training for the elastic component, because we want to keep that tissue sliding across one another efficiently. That gets us to this concept. How many people have heard of this term, biotensegrity? Tensegrity, if you've heard, yeah. Tensegrity, it's an architectural term. Biotensegrity is applying it to a biological structure. Tensegrity in architecture is a structure that balances tension, which is a pulling force, and compression, which is a shortening force. What unit of our body manages lengthening and shortening? Muscle and fascia. So when we look at what the human body is, this is a tensegrity structure where the struts are balanced within the tension. You create what they call tensional integrity. That's where we get tension tensegrity from. Fascia creates a tensegrity in our body. It's interesting to note that our bones don't actually touch. Our bones float within a web of connective tissue. So when we think bone connects to bone, that's simplistic, but it's not actually, unless you're looking at certain sutures of the skull and a couple specific joints, in general, at all the synovial movement joints, you get layers of connective tissue, you get layers of fluid, so the bones don't actually touch one another. So when we look at the bone really looks like this within all the connective tissue. So that's important. And what they're realizing is that the fascia has 10 times the sensory nerves than muscle does. So the lengthening of the fascia really can give a lot of proprioceptive feedback into the body. If all we're doing is concentric lengthening, you know, shortening, because that's what a machine focuses on, right? Is that you start with a concentric action, then you go to eccentric. But anytime we move in the body, we have to do what first? We have to do a lengthening force to get a shortening force. Anytime we move, we have to do a lengthening to shortening. Real quick, let me have everybody stand up. This kind of makes the point. And sit back down for a second. One more time, stand up. And sit back down. Now here's your challenge. I challenge you. Do not allow your upper body to move. Keep your upper body perfectly still, shoulders back, heads up. Do not allow your upper body to move. Now try to stand up. What happens if you keep your upper body perfect, you still, because when you stand up, there's a little bit of forward movement, which creates tension in the system, and that's where we get some elastic response. Or you move your feet back underneath your butt in the chair in order to get some elastic response from the body. But we cannot, movement happens from lengthening to shortening. A lot of machines train shortening to lengthening. It's not bad, it just is not complete. That's not the way the body actually moves. So we need to figure out a way that we can lengthen and work the lengthening to shortening. I just wanted to get you up a little bit, get you moving, because I know it's getting late, you've been going all day. So when we look at this, there's been a lot of work in fascia, and this is from Schleip's book, Fascia, the Structural System of the Body. But this is really important. Lack of movement fosters the development of the collagen crosslinks. So if we do the same repetitive movement patterns, if people come in and exercise, but they do the same basic 8 exercises in a machine circuit, okay, they're getting stronger, they're burning some calories, but they're creating repetitive patterns. They're not spreading the stress across the entire system. Proper loading can induce a more youthful collagen architecture. That increases elastic storage capacity. How many of us know people that are in their 60s and 70s that have been dancing or doing martial arts their entire lives? What's their movement skill like compared to somebody that hasn't? Significantly different. Significantly different. Because when you dance, when you move around, you're moving three-dimensionally, you're placing different loads on the body. Compare that to a runner, where all a runner is doing is going linearly. A dancer or a martial artist is moving in 360 degrees of motion. They're moving in multiple planes. It puts different stresses on the body. So it's not that running is wrong, but we need to look at, if people are going to run, they need to run, especially if they want to train for races, but we need to start expanding what their body can do so that it becomes more resilient to exercise, or sorry, more resilient to injury. Evidence suggests is better trained, the fascial system is better trained by a wide variety of vectors in angle, tempo, and load. And I'll put up some research on the last slide if you're interested in that. But what they're finding is, in order to get a stronger body, we need to train in multiple directions. We get this from, because my buddy that started the Institute of Motion, he used to train hockey players. He and his colleague, he used to train hockey players up in Canada. His colleague, Simon Bennett, is now the strength coach of the Oilers up in Edmonton. And what they noticed is that at the end of summer, when the kids came back into the strength room to get ready for hockey season, is you would have some kids that would be in the city, and they'd be lifting in a strength and conditioning program all summer. And then you had some other kids who'd be on the farm doing farm work 8, 10, 12 hours a day all summer. Who do you think was stronger at the beginning of hockey season? City kids or farm boys? The farm boys were much stronger, far and away. Their gym lifts weren't as strong, but they're much more injury resistant when they got on the ice. They could push the other players around on the ice. These kids might be able to bench press 300 pounds, but once they got on the ice, they didn't have the same strength as the farm kids. And so that's when my colleague really started trying to understand this and why all these different directions can change the way our body functions. Because when you look at farm work, are you doing the exact same motion the exact same way throughout the day? No. Because if you load a bale of hay into a truck, you have to move with each bale. You have to move differently. You're going to load differently. You might use your hips sometimes. You might use your back sometimes. But you want to minimize stress to your body so you find the most efficient way to load. So that's understanding how to mitigate that stress across the body. Real quick, I just want to touch on cardiorespiratory function. Again, due to time, it's kind of keeping it short. But cardiorespiratory, we can lose 10% of our cardiorespiratory function after age 25. That's per decade, 10% per decade after age 25 if we do no exercise. So if we're sedentary, if we don't do much, our heart just does not become as efficient. You know, what we lose, what we also lose, is our sensitivity to catecholamines, the epinephrine and norepinephrine responsible for energy production. One of the reasons why people can have a heart attack is in a high stress situation, the body starts dumping that into the bloodstream to elevate the heart rate. And if the heart's not trained, it can't keep up, and that's where we get a risk of heart attack. So what the research is showing is that the high intensity training, it not only creates the hormonal response, but it can create the cardiorespiratory response. So I'm going to get it to the next slide. What Gabala's lab up in Canada, and he did a major meta review of this, what Gabala found is that HIIT is not only efficient for training for improving anaerobic endurance, but HIIT training can improve mitochondrial density. So when you start looking at, you know, mitochondrial density is important for muscle tissue because it helps muscle tissue use oxygen more efficiently. So for years, and it's still accurate, we've thought is training volume as the most effective way to build mitochondrial density, but it turns out that training intensity can also be another effective way to boost mitochondrial density, both of which are very important for maintaining healthy tissue. So that's really what this is saying, is that small volume of HIIT can have many of the same benefits that a high volume of lower intensity training. So that's where a lot of interesting research is. So that gets us to programming solutions. We got just a little bit less than 10 minutes here, so that's apologize if I sped up one or two times, but we get to programming solutions because that becomes critical. What we developed at the Institute of Motion is we developed this model of exercise program design, which I think is relatively brilliant. I mean, I looked at it, when I first saw it, I'm like, duh. I developed another exercise program design model based on stress and based on kind of the Russian method of progression of movement. That's all well and good, but I saw this, I'm like, man, this makes sense to me. Because on the vertical axis, you either have a loaded exercise or you have an unloaded exercise. On the horizontal axis, you either do linear movement or you do multiplanar, multidirectional movement. Now here's the thing, the higher the load, the fewer the degrees of freedom. The higher the load, the fewer the degrees of freedom. If somebody's going for a 3RM deadlift, that weight's only coming maybe 18 to 22 inches off the ground. You're not a lot of movement there. But if you're training somebody how to be efficient at picking ground balls up off the ground, you can go with a lighter weight, like an 8-pound medicine ball, and do a little shuffle to get down, and do a little shuffle to get down. So the load drops, the degrees of freedom can increase. But what this gives us four quadrants of training. We have linear loaded training, training that's relatively consistent with what we know. That's where we get bodybuilding. We have unloaded linear training, which is running in a straight line, running, walking, cycling, moving in a straight line. We have loaded movement training, which is where it's kind of, that's where we categorize. It's kind of like the evolution of functional training. For the last 10, 12, 15 years, we've been talking about functional this, functional that. Well, really what you're looking at is you're loading movement patterns. You're putting resistance to movement patterns. And what we're finding is that resistant, multiplanar movement patterns with resistance, that's a professional rugby player doing that movement with a 20 kg Viper. Anybody go to Todd Wright's training session the other day? Todd Wright's workshop? Todd uses the Viper quite a bit with his basketball players at Texas. So Todd was in our workshop earlier this spring, going through the progressions of loaded movement training, and he understands that application. Todd and I actually went through the GIFT program together a number of years ago, that the application of functional science. So that's where Todd and I met, and we stayed in touch. So it's really cool. I've gone down the geeky, esoteric side. Todd's been in the field, so it's really cool to see how he's put that into practice in the field. But really what they're finding is with the kids at Texas and overall with the rugby players and the soccer players internationally that are using this, is they're reducing their injury. It's not so much how you can lift anymore in a linear pattern, but how can you control movement through gravity. Unloaded movement training is yoga, dance, martial arts. That's body weight, gymnastics, calisthenics. So when you look at this, this gives us an ability to develop a scatter plot of what our clients are doing. Because if you have people that are all they're doing strength training, their scatter plot's going to be here. If you have people that are doing all running, their scatter plot's going to be here. People that are doing all yoga, all dance, their scatter plot's going to be here. Not that any of it is wrong, but there's no wrong way to do it. But what do you think we need to have a healthy, structural, vibrant body? Relatively balanced. And you can skew, if you want to run the Marine Corps, you have to skew this direction. If you want to lift in a power competition, you got to skew in that direction. But we want to have a balanced way to manage and apply exercise stress. So that's what we've developed with that model. And so this is a little bit of information on movement variability. These are the studies. The interesting thing, they looked at basketball players and javelin throwers. Because if we move the exact same way, if high performers, if basketball players at the highest capability of their performance move the exact same way every time, what should free throw percentages be? Probably 90 to 100% because it's just a matter of motor pattern development. But when you look at free throw, when they looked at the free throw players, they found they set up, even though there's a lot of similarity in how they set up, they're slightly different release point, slightly different movement, everything else. So you get, you know, 60% free throw shooter is good. It's considered really good. And same thing with javelin. They saw that javelin throwers, international javelin throwers, don't throw the exact same way every time. Their pattern is relatively the same, but the actual movements are a little bit different each time. And when we look at highest performers, the high-level performers, there's a wide variance during play because I have to react to either an opponent or react to my teammate. So if I'm running a play, I'm a rugby player. If I'm running a play, there's a big difference whether I'm 1 meter in support or 3 meters in support. If I'm a football player, there's a huge difference whether I'm pulling guard or whether I'm doing a pass blocking protection, whatever the scheme might be. So there's a wide variety that athletes need. So again, I talked earlier, we should be training our clients like athletes, not the same intensities, but with the same mindset about creating variety in their movement patterns. So loaded movement training is developing task-specific strength. That's that evolution of functional training, is task-specific strength. Is my task to pick up my child? Is my task to play with my grandkid? Is my task to be able to take a 3-week cruise and be able to manage my bags or be able to manage on and off the ship and doing various hikes? You know, that's what my dad was talking about the other night. He's getting ready to retire. He wants to take a 3-week cruise. Okay, got to get you in shape for that. So when you look at it, you have variable multi-velocity movements, relating to life-like situations. We can manipulate load, direction, distance, and velocity. But as load increases, direction, distance, and velocity all decrease. And we play around. We can play around with those parameters, with those loading schemes. So here's what I found some interesting photos. Because you look at the 4Q, that's what loaded linear training gets you. That's what unloaded linear training gets you. That's what unloaded movement training gets you. And that's what loaded movement training gets you. I think wrestling is probably the best example of the loaded movement training. Because I'm a wrestler, I have to move the load of my opponent. It's not just a static load, it's a very dynamic load. So those are different body types. So it's a really good way. So you can see you have different, the reason why I put this here, if you have different fascial structures in each of those bodies. Who do you think has the healthier fascial structure? This side or this side? Probably this side. Who do you think has a stronger contractile element? Probably this side. So there's no one right way, but it's understanding how it all mixes together to create a relatively consistent and healthy body. So this creates the idea, what we talk about with the Institute of Motion is we talk about the idea of shifting our mass. Lifting a mass is going linear against the downward pull of gravity. That's where most of our body, look at most of our weight training exercises. You're moving in a curving linear, but you're relatively moving in a relatively linear pattern where most of the force is created by gravity or cam. When we talk about loaded movement training, whether you're talking about a suitcase carry, a farmer's walk, a suitcase carry, McGill's waiter carry, the stone lift, that's really the emphasis of loaded movement training. It really, because you're moving a mass through gravity. And when you look at most life situations, we look at most sports situations, it's not just moving in a linear fashion, but it's carrying a mass through gravity. I have a 6-week-old daughter that I need to carry around in her car seat. That's holding probably about a 20-pound mass here in my elbow, walking a block or two wherever I parked, and be able to shift that mass and be able to move that mass from one location to the other. We can give people that skill because if all we do is linear training, we're not training their body how to mitigate stress throughout the entire structure. So there's a balance in this. This is good. That's good. There's a balance of how we put it together. So to get back to Brad and Wilfred, because I like to come full circle when I do this stuff, if we want to help our clients look more like Brad, okay, you got to go see a plastic surgeon, but that's a little bit outside of our scope. But we want to help clients look more like Brad. We have to work the contractile and elastic component, not just weight training. Weight training is good because weight training can elevate the anabolic hormones, but we need movement training to work on the elastic component. So for testosterone production, heavier 85 to 95% 1RM, shorter rest intervals, growth hormone, we need to create higher lactate concentrations. We need to create acidosis, whether that's metabolically through cardio training or whether that's metabolically through high rep to fatigue, as Brad was talking about yesterday. But either way, we need to create acidosis. Higher intensity, volume, shorter rest intervals, big key here is sleep. So when you look at training and helping the anti-aging training, you can create anti-aging fountain of youth programs by pushing the higher intensity loads and by creating programs that increase multidimensional movement, multidirectional, multiplanar movement. So that's how we put it all together. Remember, the younger you start, the better effect you have. That's my 2-year-old. She's 2 years and 3 months. So I have a 2-year-old and a 6-week-old. I'm already starting their long-term athletic development. So talking about the last guy I was talking about, I have my 2-year-old play on the playground for the 5-year-olds and up. So I got her skill training. But you can check out what we're doing at instituteofmotion.com. You can follow us on Facebook. We put a lot of information up there. We put a lot of information on here. Twitter feeds, both Institute of Motion and my Twitter feed, FitExpert Pete. I don't like that, but it's what my last job gave me. And they're doing a lot. They spent a lot of time promoting that. I don't like self-glossing FitExpert. I haven't decided what else to call it, so I've kind of kept it there. Instagram, I'm doing some work with Reebok, and all the people I work with at Reebok are on Instagram. So I had to go on Instagram to see what the heck they were up to. The research here, obviously you can, I didn't even put my email up there. You can get a hold of me through Institute of Motion. I'm sorry about that. But I can email you these slides if you're interested, or I can give you, if you give me your information afterwards. So guys, thank you very much. Hopefully this gave you a couple ideas.